talking with Manuel Pastor. He's a professor of American Studies at the University of the University of Southern California. He's the author of a new book, State of Resistance, What California's Dizzying Ascent and Remarkable Resurgence Means for California's Future. This is a half-hour segment. Also get in touch with us on Twitter and Facebook. We're at KQED Forum, or you can email your questions. We're at forum@kqed.org, or just post them on our website. That's kqed.org/forum. And Manuel Pastor, I was wondering, you mentioned this is how we can proceed going forward with the racial generation divide that you were talking about.
Well, it certainly was made easier by the fact of a kind of common investment in whiteness. But I think the folks who give people the name will achieve mobility over time. I think those are really, really crucial parallels. But what the story really does tell us is that any way we try to think about having a conversation about California, the Trump election, there's a lot of debate about whether we should focus in on class or focus in on race. And I guess that's typical of Americans, that we think we can't do two things at the same time. You can't really deal with somebody's economic questions unless you deal with the issues of race and racism. For example, problems like food confronting a coal miner West Virginia have very little to do with immigration from Mexico. There are not a lot of Mexicans clamoring to move to
the
island.
Might have contributed to this upswing, and one of them is, you know, obviously better economy, rise in the tech sector. Can you speak about that?
Well, it's a little bit different. It's a kind of rise in the tech sector. I think it comes with the other part of voters in the way that joblessness does not. And that meant that there was a lot of effort that was put into unionization, a lot of effort put into even organizers to raise things. I mean, the first winning wage ordinances, the first community benefits agreements, the first pushes for minimum wage increases came out of the organizing in Southern California, essentially because business was less coherent there.
And you also mentioned, and you said, we don't want to make too much of this, but the business groups have really been taking the lead, at least up here. You mentioned the Silicon Valley Leadership Group.
The Parkland victims. And victims of the kind of gun violence that's become routine for some Oakland students.
On November 28th, 2011, three gunmen connected to a West Oakland gang fired into a crowd, wounding seven people and killing a child named Hiram Lawrence Jr. Hiram was just 1 year old. May he rest in peace.
I now want to invite Alonzo Henderson to
about, like, what I'm doing right now, about how it's raining, but we're still outside, and we're still standing in support with everyone who have lost their life.
By the end of the walkout, Maxwell and Caroline were soaked, but already planning their next move.
A lot of these students have kind of come together. We might form a club. So like a student activist, student action clubs.
I want to keep this up and keep actions going, but I just honestly, I just want to say, like, you know, the youth, like, don't undermine us, because we're coming for you, and we're gonna make change.
Next up, another anniversary and another walkout. April 20th, Columbine. I'm Vanessa Rancagno, KQED News.
Now, let's go to Palo Alto, where 81% of residents who took a recent survey said they consider themselves middle class, even though by national standards, they'd be considered wealthy. KQED's senior Silicon Valley editor Tanya Mosley talked with the author of the survey about what these findings might reveal about the people who call Palo Alto home.
I met writer Fiona Kelleher in downtown Palo Alto.